Hello friends, welcome back to Tutorials in English Literature. In today's lesson, I shall focus on the transitional poets of 18th century. In their poetry, we notice a spirit of transition. Transition from neoclassicism to romanticism. So they are also known as precursor of romanticism. In the last lecture, we have find that the 18th century is usually known as the century of prose and reason, the age in which neoclassicism reigned supreme and in which all romantic tendencies lay dormant, if not extinct. But that is a verdict too comprehensive to be true. In this century, especially at the last part, especially at the age of Johnson, we can see numerous cracks in the classical edifice through which seems to be peeping the multicolored light of romanticism. In the latter years of this century, a large number of new influences were at work on English sensibility and temper. The change signalized a change in the ethos of poetry. In fact, literature as a whole, the younger poets started breaking away from the school of Dryden and Pope. Even though some poets like Churchill and Dr. Johnson still elected to remain in the old group, there were very few poets indeed who set themselves completely free from the old traditional influences. Most of them are looking simultaneously at the neoclassical past and the romantic future. In the selection of subjects for poetic treatment, in the choice of verse patterns, and in the manner of treatment, we meet with perceptible changes from the conventions of the neoclassical school. Let us sum up the romantic qualities of the poetry of these transitional poets, and you can realize how far is it from the neoclassical tenets that I have discussed in the last video. The first point is that these poets believe in what Victor Hugo describes as liberalism in literature. Not much worried about rules and conventions, they believe in individual poetic inspiration. The second thing is that their poetry is not altogether intellectual in content and treatment. Passion, emotion, and the imagination are valued by them above the cold light of intellectuality. They naturally return to the lyric. They have a love of the wild, fantastic, abnormal, and supernatural. And this third point is also a hallmark of romanticism. The fourth point is that they show a new appreciation of the world of nature, which the neoclassical poetry had mostly neglected. They do not limit their attention to urban life like the neoclassical poets and manners only, as Pope almost always did. In the fifth place, we find that they place more importance on the individual than on society. In them, therefore, is to be seen at work a stronger democratic spirit, a greater concern for the oppressed and the poor, and a greater emphasis on individualism in poetry, in society, everywhere. Their poetry becomes much more subjective. On the sixth point, we can find that they show a much greater interest in the Middle Ages, which Dryden and Pope, the two greatest masters of neoclassicism, had neglected on account of their alleged barbarousness. In this period, new sources are discovered, like the medieval times and the northern literature, the Celtic, Scandinavian. We find it in Thomas Chatterton's Rowley poems and James Macpherson's Oceanic poetry. Lastly, there is a strong reaction against the heroic couplet as the only eligible verse unit. We know that heroic couplet dominated in the scene of neoclassical poetry. But these new poets make experiments with new measures and stanzaic forms. The descriptive and narrative poems began again, as we find in Oliver Goldsmith's The Deserted Village. The revival of the ballad is also very significant change of this period. While exhibiting all these above listed tendencies in their poetic works, the transitional poets are not, however, altogether free from neoclassicism. That is exactly why they are not full-fledged romantics, but only transitional poets. Nevertheless, their work proves the 18th century was an age of reason, but the channels of romanticism were never dry. Let us now consider the work of the most important transitional poets of the 18th century, especially the last part, which is known also as the transitional age or the age of sensibility. The first poet of our discussion is James Thomson. Though he was contemporaneous with Alexander Pope, yet he broke away from the traditions of the school of neoclassicism to explore fresh woods and pastures new. He bade goodbye to the heroic couplet and wrote in blank verse and the Spenserian stanza, which were held supreme in Elizabethan age. He would have acknowledged Spenser and Milton as his guides rather than Dryden and Pope, the neoclassical masters. His famous poem, Seasons, is important for accurate and sympathetic descriptions of natural scenes. It is entirely different from such poems as Pope's Windsor Forest, on account of the poet's first-hand knowledge of what he is describing and his intimate connection, rapport with it. Thomson's Castle of Indolence is in Spenserian stanzas, and it captures much of the luxuriant, imaginative color of the Elizabethan poet. Remember that Elizabethan age is the first romantic age. Thomson looks forward to the romantics in his interest in nature, in treating of new subjects, his strong imagination, and his giving up of the heroic couplet. But he is capable of some very egregious, striking examples of neoclassical poetic diction. Even Dr. Johnson, who was a great supporter of neoclassicism, was constrained to observe his diction is in the highest degree florid and luxuriant. He commented that it is too exuberant and sometimes may be charged with filling the ear more than the mind. The second poet of importance is Thomas Gray. Gray started his career as a straight-jacketed classicist, pure classicist, and ended as a genuine romantic. His work is a kind of epitome of the changes which were coming over the literature of his time. His first attempt, The Alliance of Education and Government and the Ode on the Distant Prospect of Eton College, were classical in spirit and in its use of the heroic couplet. But his magnum opus, that is the elegy written in a country churchyard, is altogether different. There is first the use of nature, which though employed only as a background, is still handled with fidelity and sympathy. There is next the churchyard scene, the twilight atmosphere and brooding melancholy of the poem, which at once connected the development of the distinctive romantic mood. The contrast drawn between the country and the town, the peasant's simple life and the madding crowd's ignoble strife, is the third particular which will be noted. Finally, in the tender feeling, song for the rude forefathers of the hamlet, we see poetry under the influence of the spreading democratic spirit. Gray's next poems, The Progress of Poesy and The Bird, present a new conception of the poet, not as a clever versifier, wittier versifier, but a genuinely inspired and prophetic genius. His last poems, like The Fatal Sisters and The Descent of Odin, are romantic fragments with which we step out of the 18th century and find ourselves in the full stream of Romanticism. Another important poet of this group is William Collins. Collins' poetry is distinguished by its high imaginative quality and by exquisitely felicitous descriptive phrases, which is close to Romanticism. He exercised pervasive influence on almost all the Romantic poets. He finds that landscape evokes ideas and emotions. He particularly loves nature at twilight. His ode to evening is the forerunner of Keats' ode to autumn. Romantic tendencies such as the return to the past and anti-intellectualism may be noticed in his ode on popular superstitions. Coleridge is impressed with Collins' use of superstitions and classical legends. Collins is the first among the transitional poets to rediscover the technical secrets of lyrical poetry, and this lyric is the hallmark of Romanticism. Our next poet of discussion is William Cowper. He is similarly influential. He is a blend of the old and the new, with much of the form of the old and something of the spirit of the new. In his satires, he imitated the manner of Pope, but his greatest poem, The Task, is all his own. It is written in blank verse and contains the famous line, "God made the country and man made the town," which indicates his love of nature and simplicity. However, the classical element in him is more predominant than the romantic. Yet, throughout Cowper's work, we feel from time to time a note of something that is certainly not the note of Pope or Dryden, something deeper in feeling that meets us even in Thomson, Collins, or Gray. There is a tenderness in poems like My Mother's Picture that not even Goldsmith in his verse can quite equal. While his phrase and intimate nature pictures point to a stage in the development of poetic naturalism, Cowper also attacks Alexander Pope for his smoothness and advocates the manly rough line. This idea is later developed by Wordsworth. Cowper anticipated the romantic generation in his political liberalism, in his humanitarianism, and most of all in his sympathetic and faithful rendering of external nature. And all these things are very important characteristics of romantic poetry. Robert Burns is another famous member of the precursors of Romanticism. He was a Scottish peasant who took to poetry and became the truly national poet of Scotland. His works, poems chiefly in the Scottish dialect, which was published in 1786, skyrocketed him to fame. All these poems are imbued with the spirit of romantic lyricism in its untutored spontaneity, humor, pathos, and sympathy with nature and her lowly creatures, the downtrodden, including the sons of the soil. The love and sympathy for humanity informs all his poems. His poetry is charged with emotion and passion, which sets him apart from Augustan school, the neoclassical school. His poems are also subjective. Burns was influenced a great deal by the spirit of French Revolution. His fellow feeling extended even to the lower animals that he studied minutely and treated sympathetically. All of these transitional poets are lesser in romantic spirit in comparison with William Blake. Blake was an out-and-out rebel against the social, political, and literary conventions of the 18th century. It is with considerable inaccuracy that he can be included among the transitional poets or the precursors of Romantic Revival, as in many ways, he is even more romantic than the Romantic poets. The most undisciplined and the most lonely of all poets, he lived in his own world, peopled by phantoms and spectres, whom he treated as more real than the humdrum realities of physical world. His glorification of childhood and feeling for nature bring him close to the romantic poets. He is best known for his three thin volumes. First is Poetical Sketches, the second is Songs of Innocence, and the third is Songs of Experience, which was published together with Songs of Innocence. These volumes contain some of his most precious gems of English lyricism. His passion for freedom was also akin to that which moved Wordsworth, Coleridge, and Southey in their earlier years. Though in its latter form, it came nearer to Shelley's revolt against conventions, social conventions. There is indeed an unusual degree of fellowship between these two poets, the imagery and symbolism, as well as the underlying spirit. The Revolt of Islam, Alastair, and Prometheus Unbound of Shelley find their nearest parallel in Blake's prophetic books. Both had visions of a world regenerated by a gospel of universal brotherhood, transcending law that binds human beings. So I am concluding my discussions here. If you like this lesson, please hit the like button. If you still have any doubt or query, you can ask me in the comment section. I also request you to subscribe to my channel, where you will get a regular update of this kind of quality content. That's all for today.